morning, everyone. What a blessing to be back inside, huh? Boy, well, we'll continue to pray for God's protection for all of you, and God bless you all tuning in as well. What a privilege and a blessing to be back here, back home. Welcome back, everyone. Let's prepare our hearts for worship this morning. God, our God, how glorious is your name in all the earth. Your glory is sung by all of your creation. When we look to the heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon, the stars, we wonder, who are we that you are mindful for us in this world? You are the God of life, crowning us with glory and honor, and we serve you all our days. O God, our God, how glorious is your name in all the earth. Would you join me in prayer, please? Father, when the world divides us, come, Holy Spirit, make us one. When the world calls us orphaned, come, Holy Spirit, make us a family. When the world leads us astray, come, Holy Spirit, call us home. Come, Holy Spirit, come. Come, fill this place. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. And the church said, amen. Let's stand, and we have some songs that we're going to worship together with.
I will listen. You're a Prince of Peace, and I will live my life for you. You're a Prince of Peace, and I will live my life for you.
Amen. You may be seated. There's a lot to pray for in our community, in our church, in our nation, in the world. And let's take some time now and lift our concerns, our joys, our gratitude, and our needs to our Father in heaven, and I'll close us. Let's take some time and pray to our Father.
Spreading your word, that we love your glory, just emanating from you. into the name of Jesus. Lift you all up to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Lord, I pray for a 28-year-old boy and a man who is in the hospital of Boston and dying of cancer. Lord, I ask that you would support his family, that you would speak to him. Lord, you can breathe fresh life and healing into his body. You can even raise him from the dead. Lord, we thank you that you are empowered by God. But we also understand, Lord, that we can't control what is planned for him. We just ask, Lord, that you give strength to all people, his family and his friends. Jesus' name.
Lord, we lift up those who are not able to come or can work. We're already so sad that they cannot be here. Now we're with them. We're watching them. So we're not there. Jack, Daphne, and so many others. For missing this time of just being together again, smiling, sharing with one another at a distance. In this building, sometime soon.
Father, we thank you for our opportunities to share with your work around the world. We thank you that the boys are back at Rancho del Rey, that things are going well, that people are healthy, that schoolwork is getting done, that relationships are being built, and we thank you that the boys who are going to back-to-back are allowed to go there as well and resume their studies at the high school level, college level. We pray also for Rachel Wallstein as she did receive her visa and she's headed back to India this week. We pray that you will give her traveling, help her travel to go smoothly. We thank you for the work that's being done there, and we pray that you will continue to, your name will continue to be broadcast there in that dark place. In the name of Jesus, we pray.
Heavenly Father, we pray too for the former El Rancho boy who performed last night, Pastor Fidel, whose house and car were destroyed in the fire. We pray for them that they can recover quickly. I'm sure that El Rancho will share some of their resources with them, but that it just increases the need all around. So we pray for Pastor Fidel and his church and his own family, Lord, that his house can be restored quickly and his vehicle. Thank you for their ministry in Monterey, that's Fidel and his church. Thank you for the incredible work they're doing in an extremely difficult place, and we pray that they can be made whole very quickly. And people will be responsible to help out with that. In Jesus' name, I pray.
Father, I give you praise for the new baby that brothers had, Lucas and Becca, and we pray that they're able to get the passport they need for this little one, so that they can head back to Senegal as soon as possible. They're looking forward to it and ready to go. And there have been very few cases of COVID there, and they'd like to get back to their mission and ministry. And we thank you for that healthy baby. Jesus' name.
Lord, thank you for the light of this new day. Work of my life, and that in the journey I can take one step at a time with you. Thank you for this congregation, pray for all the here, not here. Continue to give us strength to move forward with you. And even though there are baby steps that we're taking, they are steps in the right direction. As long as we walk with you. I pray today also for my daughter, Melinda, having issues medically going on in the body. She has four boys. She can't afford to take her own time off. Has to be issues. So be with her, give her strength. Figure out what's going on. And I pray, Lord, that help others in similar situations. We can be healed. Having faith in you, everything that you mean in our lives. And the colors of the fall, and the breath of fresh air, give us the strength to continue all your beauty and splendor. Thank you for all of this, and more to come. In Jesus' name we pray.
Father, we thank you that you hear our prayers, every single one of them, Lord. And by the power of your Spirit, you hear those prayers even that we're fearful to put words to, God. And we thank you, Lord, that you answer prayer, most of the time maybe not in the way that we would understand answer and need, Lord, but you take care of us. Scripture says that you are our provider and our shelter. And we call on that protection, we call on that provision, Lord, in such a chaotic time. What a blessing, Lord, that you opened up the doors safely for us to be in here, Lord. We pray your protection as we gather. We pray your protection as the church body virtually gathers as well online. We thank you for this technology, Lord, that allows us to do this. But with that comes a responsibility, Lord, to stick to your word, to stick to a clear vision of Jesus, and a clear call on the Holy Spirit to bless everything that we do in your name, God. So, Lord, open up the airwaves, and we just thank you, Lord, that you are above all things. Even something that's spreading and we don't even see it, God. We know you're in control. We know you're doing something good in all of this. And Lord, we listen. We're ready as your people, as you need us, Lord, to join in with the work that you're doing individually and as the body, physically, virtually, Lord, wherever you have us. We are all important members, vital members of the body. And Paul tells us that when one of us is hurting, when one of us is lonely, when one of us is depressed or anxious, that that affects the whole body, Lord. So help us to respond to each other. Help us to check in. And we pray for health for the body, Lord. And we thank you for the words that you gave us, Lord. If we have trouble finding words in time with you, Lord, you still give us an avenue of communication in the Lord's Prayer. We pray that right now, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. I don't have too many announcements. Just I'd like to point out a couple dates to you all. November 2nd, Monday, is our revival prayer that Monica, thank you, Monica, that you lead. 6:30, and depending on the number, we've been gathering in the foyer with the doors open, and it's worked really well. So keep that date in mind. And then Revival prayer is the first and third Monday, so the 16th will be the next revival prayer after that. And then Wednesday 4th, November 4th, will be all church prayer. Again, depending on our numbers, we've been gathering in the foyer, again, with the doors open, masks. So keep that all in prayer, and we just are so grateful that Greenwoods is a praying church. God bless all of you. Jane, did you want to make an Operation Christmas Child announcement?
Yes, we're starting to get some people bringing in their boxes, which is wonderful. We're also having a church packing party without the party part. And you should have gotten an announcement in your email on Saturday, I guess it was.
Yeah.
So it'll be the 6th and 7th, Friday the 6th and 7th. You call me or email me for a time slot between 1 and 5 on Friday and between 9 and 2 on Saturday. You can come in and pack alone. Everything will be spread out. If you want to have a family group, up to 4, I'll be available. I'll stay in my car if you don't want anybody around. And that way we can pool all our stuff. And if you have some leftovers from your unpacking or you want to join in the pool, we have some things that have been made and contributed by members of the congregation. So mostly clothing items and school supplies. So we look forward to that. Thank you.
Thank you, Jane. Chuck.
Just thanks to the owners for getting this church open again.
Yes.
I know it's been a long struggle for everybody, but it's been done right.
Yes.
Thank God for that, but especially thank my convoy for doing the parking lot.
Yeah.
It's been needed for a couple of years. It's been fun. So to do it, I know it's a lot of work, and it's great.
I'd like to say a special thank you to our team, Jesse on the computer, Danielle and Becca on the soundboard, Mike on the soundboard as well. You all have been such a blessing in this weird technology stuff, so just thank you. You've been the rudder, the steady calm in the midst of the craziness for me at least, so you're doing a wonderful job. Bless you guys. Thank you. Any other announcements? Anyone have anything? No? Well, again, good morning. What a blessing to be here. What a blessing to see you all this morning. Welcome home. Thank you, family, for bearing with us through this weird time together. Thank you for your patience, your generosity, your persistent prayers, your faithful presence in person and online. Thank you. Thank you. We're all in this together. And as I believe God has proven to us over and over and over, we are indeed better together, physically and virtually. Amen? Yes, we are. I'm putting our series on grace on hold for a couple weeks. I'd like us to take some time this morning and focus on God's blessings. We need to be grateful. We need to be thankful that no matter what's going on, He is always in charge. In John chapter 16, Jesus says, in this world you will have trouble. Not you might have trouble. You will have trouble. Meaning, you can expect difficulty in your life. You can count on challenges. Plan on upheaval. And I think over the last 8-9 months, I think we've all seen all kinds of trouble, haven't we? Physical trouble with this virus, the social distancing, the isolation, the loneliness. Emotional trouble, it's really affected me emotionally. Depression, division, anger, worry, fear, panic. And spiritual trouble, not being able to do church the way we're used to doing church. So now we experience maybe disconnection from our church family. Maybe even we feel disconnected from God. Of the many, many lessons that our Bibles teach us, one of the fundamental things we learn is that even in the midst of chaos, turmoil, upheaval, God blesses His people. In fact, it might take some upheaval in our lives to get us to our knees in order to see and acknowledge and praise God for His blessings. You know, another thing about Scripture that continues to astound me is this enduring fact. God's word is timeless. It's amazing. You know, here are some challenges God's people suffered through in Scripture: earthquakes, floods, droughts, famine, outbreaks of nasty plagues and viruses, hurricanes, monsoons, corrupt leaders, infected regimes, slavery, bigotry, embittered racism, persecution, and the list goes on and on and on, but kind of sounds like today's modern world, doesn't it? But as we read through these troubles of God's people, I pray we're learning that God's presence, God's blessings are steady. They're firm, they're constant, all the time. Amen? As long as we cling to Him, Jeremiah 29 promises that our God will never, ever forsake us. I take comfort in that. And that's a promise right from the mouth of our Father in heaven. We're going to look at another promise this morning, direct from God's mouth. God's promise of blessing in Numbers chapter 6, if you brought your Bibles with you. Numbers 6, starting in verse 24, that's where we'll be looking. On the surface, it seems to be just sort of a short, simple blessing. You know, songs have been written to these words using this blessing. You'll find this blessing on keychains and coffee mugs, social media posts and threads. You'll hear the word blessing after someone sneezes, God bless you. You'll see the word on doormats, framed on walls in homes. We pray a quick blessing before many of our meals, especially at special times throughout the year. When we're down and out, we're told to count our blessings. You'll even hear the word blessing in sermon titles, trying to be hip and trendy, right? You're blessed to be a blessing. We tell our friends or the representative on the phone, have a blessed day, right? Hopefully. Do we really know what a blessing is, though? I mean, is offering a blessing simply equivalent to blurting out, have a nice day? Is it equivalent to, you know, wishing happy thoughts, good feelings, good luck? Oh, look, I found a 20 on the sidewalk. What a blessing. Here we are again, face to face with yet another word that seems to have been stripped and watered down, robbed of its biblical impact. Let's take some time and recontextualize what a blessing from God is. Let's take it back from the world, right? And place it once again in God's hands. Let's see what a blessing is in God's eyes. So here's the blessing we're going to be exploring. Numbers chapter 6. And actually, a couple verses back, we'll start in verse 22. The Lord said to Moses, "Tell Aaron and his sons, this is how you are to bless the Israelites. Say to them, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace." You know, it's interesting. There's a pretty common misconception that's been going around for centuries. Who was this blessing for? Many say it's for Aaron and his sons, but what does God tell Moses? Tell Aaron and his sons, this is how you are to bless the Israelites. This blessing is for everyone. It's for all of us even. Historically, this very blessing, which the Jewish people knew word for word, you know, when offered, would cause everyone within earshot, rich, poor, carpenter, clergy, butcher, baker, candlestick maker, everyone to stop, drop to their knees, and receive the blessing. You know, even kings would bow down when offering or receiving this blessing. It's a bit more than a smiley emoji, isn't it? Or a good luck with everything, don't you think? You know, it was never simplified. It was certainly never paraphrased or amended. It was sacred. It was profound. It was personal. It was powerful. And it instantly brought everyone to their knees. I think we need to reclaim this blessing for today, don't you think? Let's take a short walk through these few verses and see if we can recapture what's really being said here. The first phrase says, "The Lord bless you and keep you." As is often true with these wonderful biblical languages, Old Testament Hebrew, New Testament Greek, there's several words that are translated as blessing. In fact, Hebrew has 10 words, and the Greek has 11 words that we translate as bless or blessing. The Hebrew word used here in Numbers 6 is barak. It's used over 200 times in the Bible. The first appearance of the word is in Genesis chapter 1, verse 22. There, God blesses the fish in the sea, blesses the birds in the air, and commands them to be fruitful and multiply. And then a few verses later, he offers a similar blessing on humankind, whom he created and fashioned in his own image. And the third time that God blesses and uses this word is at the beginning of Genesis chapter 2, when God blesses the seventh day, makes it holy, a day of rest. When the word barak is used, it primarily and immediately is a sign of acknowledgement of God's favor. It's a fascinating word. When blessing his people, Israel, in Numbers, for instance, God promises prosperity, health, fertility, long lineage, numerous offspring, success in work and trade, victory in battle, success at home, peace with friends and family, and deep rest at night. We're barely even scratching the surface of this word. In Deuteronomy chapter 16, verse 15, Moses says, "The Lord your God will bless you in all your produce and in all the work of your hands, so that you will be altogether joyful." You know, that little verse there, it's not wishful thinking there. It's not have a nice day or good luck. It's a rich, deep, beautiful promise to Israel. And did you notice it's also a conditional promise? The promise is dependent on Israel's faithfulness, as the context of Numbers 6 clearly indicates. Additionally, the promise, the blessing, it's rooted in God's power. It's administered in his covenant of faithful love. When God blesses, things always change. Amen? For the better. But wait, there's more. You know what's remarkable? The original meaning of the word barak literally means on bended knee. It refers specifically to the position and posture in which one kneels before another on bended knee. You know, think of a man dropping down to his knee to ask for a woman's hand in marriage. I think we all could agree at that moment that it warrants a reverential posture, yes? We've probably seen movies and shows about days long, long ago where a king or a knight resolved to go forth and conquer some enemies. And those who pledged loyalty to follow the conquering hero would demonstrate their allegiance by kneeling down before him on one knee. That's barak. That's to bless. Anyone here remember the scene from Lord of the Rings, The Return of the King? It's also in the book. I love this scene at the end. Aragorn is finally crowned king of all men in Middle-earth. What a journey, however, he's endured to get to this coronation. At the ceremony, he glances over to the four hobbits who were integral to the success of his journey. And what does he do? Everyone there is dropping to their knees. Does he, freshly crowned, newly anointed, demand that these little ones show loyalty and submission to him? He has every right to, right? I mean, after all, it's good to be the king. No, at this moment, as the hobbits look to each other and as they begin to bow, he, Aragorn, the king himself, immediately kneels down before them as his sign of loyalty to them "My friends," he exclaims with tears, "you bow to no one." It's a very powerful and touching scene in both the book and the movie. And that's exactly what God's blessing of his people illustrates. God stooping down from heaven, actually offering to come to his people on bended knee. Do we get this? I mean, this means that our Heavenly Father comes to us to serve us, to love us, to share himself with us. That's Barak, and I think it's pretty cool, right? It's a richly wonderful word. Pastor Hans Krauss says this: a little girl once described her experience in an elevator. She said, "I got into this little room, and the upstairs came down." I love that. God comes down to meet us at our level, where we are. He did so at Christmas in the person of Jesus, his son. He did so at Pentecost in the person of the Holy Spirit. Such is the love of God, that he bends down to bless us because we are unable to reach up to him. I love that. The Lord bless you and keep you. What does it mean that God keeps us? Thank you for asking. Good question. The word used here is shamar. It's related to shamir, which means thorn. The picture that God paints here is that of a shepherd. When the shepherd was out in the wilderness with his flock, he would construct a paddock of thorns and bushes to protect the sheep from predatory animals at night. The thorns prevented wild animals from getting in from the outside, keeping the flock safe within. But at the same time, the thorns on the inside were also effective in keeping the flock safe, keeping them back from trying to wander out of the pen, from going astray. It's interesting, isn't it? The fence was also necessary to keep the flock in the protective care of the shepherd. Comforting imagery, isn't it? God promises to protect us, his people. He is our good shepherd. He promises to protect his sheep in the desert, in the wild, in this world. And sometimes the thorns can be painful, can't they? As we try to wander and stray or push the boundaries from the flock. But we've got to remember that those thorns are not there to harm us. They're there to keep us together, friends. Close to God, close to one another. We're better and safer together. Amen? I mean, the thorns protect us from the danger that's all around us in this world. In John chapter 10, verses 27 to 28, Jesus says, "My sheep listen to my voice. I know them, and they follow me. I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish. No one can snatch them out of my hand." In the first line of this blessing that we're exploring in Numbers 6, it assures us of God's promise to take good care of us. He kneels down before us to provide for us. Not only what we need, but plenty, plenty, right? And he builds a fence around us to protect us from any harm, from outside, all the while keeping us close to him. Comforting imagery. I know it is for me. What are the thorns we're dealing with now? Today, I'm having a tough time preaching in this mask. Social distancing and isolation, that's been really hard on me. I mean, yes, these things are inconvenient, but we're to use these masks, we're to try to keep from each other during this time for our and each other's protection. You know, but no one can take my rights away from me. Rights. Rights. What rights? Your right not to wear a mask and be reckless towards everyone else. Your right to choose not to keep a distance from others, which literally puts everyone's health at risk, and in turn continuing to spread this elusive virus, thereby forcing the rest of us in the world to continue to have to wear these masks and keep apart. You see how it's not about individual rights. We're all in this together, this thing called life, right? And we're all responsible to one another. No one can tell the church not to gather. I've heard that argument over and over. Okay, why are you coming to that? I'm sorry to call it an illogical conclusion, but it is. No one's telling the church not to gather, friends. Our government has actually encouraged us to gather as God's people. And there's a safe way to do so, with masks keeping apart, limiting how many of us are inside in an enclosed space. And that's it. It's not about rights. It's not about anyone telling us what to do. It's far more simple. It's far more calm. And it's reasonable. Yes? It's actually what Jesus tells us to do as God's people. Love God. Love others as you love yourself. So I'm wearing this mask. We're wearing these masks. We're keeping apart from each other. We're limiting how many of us can gather safely inside for you, for your safety, for the community's safety. And that's it. I mean, remember, we're all in this thing called life together. We're all responsible to one another. You know, when God told the Israelites in Egypt to keep inside while the angel of death struck down every firstborn child, did the Israelites complain? Come on, God. You can't take away my right to go outside. Well, God's not taking away anyone's rights. He's not telling them to forsake our free will. And I hope we see this. Like the Israelites are going outside and neglecting these simple precautions for now puts everyone at risk. It's a life and death decision to do either. So, you know, I'm wearing this mask. I'm choosing not to shake your hand and it breaks my heart or give you a hug or put a hand on your shoulder for your safety and for mine, especially for those who are most at risk. Do I need to wear this mask for myself? Well, that's an irrelevant question. You know, I'm sorry to be so blunt, but so many are complicating something so simple. We just need to be inconvenienced for a little bit as we think of others. Just because we have no symptoms doesn't mean that the virus still isn't spreading. So be conscious of the distance between you and everyone else, just for a while, for the good of everyone. That's all. And you know what? We're all in this together. You know what I see when I see you all wearing a mask, keeping a distance? I see love, friends. Not only are you thinking about your safety, the mask, the distance, it's clear evidence that you're concerned about my welfare and I'm concerned about yours. That's it. Amen? The Lord bless you. The Lord keep you. We're living out this blessing by patiently dealing with these thorns, by wearing these masks, by practicing social distancing. And as we do, God will continue to pour out his amazing blessings on every single one of us. Please come back next week. What a blessing to be inside, isn't it? I love being back at this pulpit. Come next week as we continue to walk through this timeless blessing in Numbers 6, this blessing from God. Until then, please be safe, please be prudent, and be calm, and be who you are in God's eyes. Let's pray. Father in heaven, you're so gracious to your people. We just thank you for your provision. And Lord, I have the image of the cup overflowing, Lord. Not only do you provide, you overflow with blessing. Yes, to prosper us and our families and our friends, but there's more than enough to share with everyone else, God, in your provision, in your blessing. Lord, I thank you that you chose these languages of Hebrew, Greek, even Aramaic, that are so deep and so rich. I thank you, Lord, that you've given us tools to explore these words in these languages, Lord, so that we can learn more about you and just how much you care and love us and your creation. And then the challenge for us to go and do likewise and share that love with everyone else. I thank you that we're back inside, Lord. We pray particular blessing that we would all be safe. Anyone who walks through these doors, Lord, and would just feel safe and feel loved by you and each other. Thank you for everyone here and everyone tuning in online. Just pray a blessing on them. And Lord, keep us safe, keep us whole, keep us healthy, keep us mindful of you and each other, and keep us calm, Lord. We love you and we